What's going on, everyone? Hope you're all doing well. I'm a bit tired from working this competition this past weekend, so that's why this video is a day late as well, because I had to work the competition on Saturday and Sunday, plus handle one lifter during one of the sessions, then pack up everything on Monday, and then drive back home on Monday. I've been catching up on emails and all kinds of other work that I've been doing. So now I thought I'd put a quick video together to go over basically the one lifter who competed this past weekend and go over maybe how not only his performance went, but maybe something that you guys can take away. So we'll get right into it. And the first thing will be is making sure you bring all your equipment, because what happened is he weighed in and everything like that. And then when it was time to start warming up, he realized that he left his belt back at home. He never packed it. So now we have to decide what we're gonna do. So one of the obvious things would be like, okay, we'll just drop all the attempts for squat and deadlift and just go for beltless. This is the first competition, so we would just do, you know, beltless squat and deadlift, do the benches regular, set those numbers, and then go from there. But we tried talking to people to see what we can do, and what we end up doing is one of the spotters and loaders had a belt. It's more of a flimsy belt, but at least it was a little bit of support. And he said, yeah, it's fine, we can use his belt. So we used his belt on squats. And then once we were getting to deadlifts, there was actually two platforms going, and the platform that spotter was on finished faster than the platform we were on. So between sessions, he wanted to get a training session in the warm-up room real quick, and he wanted to use his belt. So then what we had to do is ask someone else. So one of the lifters that were on the same platform as us, putting the flight before us, finished his deadlifts, and then we were able to use his belt, which was an SPD belt. So it actually turned out better that he was able to use, you know, a really good belt for the deadlift, where he used the thinner, flimsier belt on squat. So we had to use, you know, one belt on squat, one belt on deadlift, and neither one was his belt. So for you lifters out there, whether you're a beginner or advanced lifters, always make sure you're packing all your stuff. Don't forget everything. Anytime I travel, I always look around my room like, oh man, I know I forgot something, and try and double, triple check. But what you can do is make a checklist of all your equipment that you need, as far as your shoes for each lift, your wrist wraps for each lift, your belt for each lift, t-shirt, underwear, singlet, knee sleeves, all that kinds of stuff like that. And then make sure you have everything packed, because once you go to a competition, it's very difficult to find that stuff, because they don't typically, you know, sell them at like a sporting goods store or like at a Walmart, something like that. And it's gonna be difficult to get from someone else, because you need to have the same size as them. And you're gonna have to, you know, ask them if you can borrow it. If they're, you know, if they're lifting, they may not want to give that stuff up while they're competing, or if they're, you know, in a later session, they wouldn't want you to break it or something like that before they get to compete. So just make sure you have a checklist and you're getting all your stuff packed before you leave town. So we'll now go into the numbers, and you can see how I made some changes on the day of. When I'm not at the competition, I make a game plan for the lifter that I know is gonna be high percentage chance of them making all their lifts. So I tend to be a little bit more conservative, because I'm not there to see things and make adjustments in real time if we need to. So I make things a little bit more conservative. So even if they take the top third attempt, I know that it's gonna be high probability that they're gonna make it. But if I'm gonna be there, then I can see everything live from, you know, how much they weighed in, how they're feeling that day, how warm-ups are going, how the judges are calling things, and make adjustments along the way. So for this, I actually did make some adjustments. So we'll go into the actual numbers. He was doing one of my free programs, and the highest squat he hit in my program was a 325-pound squat. But in previous cycles before this, before I met him, he was doing more than 325 pounds. So there was the potential he can do more than 325. It was just the highest out for the percentage of his one rep max that he hit in this training cycle. So my original plan was to do 137.5 for the opener, which is 303, 145 for the second attempt, which is 319. And then from there, the third pick between 150 and 152.5, 330, 336, depending on how that second attempt went. Since he hit the 325 in training, I said, okay, let's see if we can hit the 330 or 336 now that he's peaked and ready for competition. What ended up happening, and you'll see in the videos, is that 303 was super easy, 319 was just as easy, or maybe even easier. So what I said is, okay, let's go a little bit off of what I do as far as strategy for attempt selection, and let's take a bigger jump. Since he has hit more in training in the previous cycles, and the second attempt looked like, you know, a warm up, let's take a bigger jump and let's go to 155, 341 pounds, and take that bigger jump and see if we can, you know, get more out of the squat. And as you can see, it was a little bit of grinder through the middle, but he was able to get it. So this is something that I don't regularly do, but if you are gonna break the rule like I did, and that, you know, other people may do, is try and set a specific thing that the person has to hit or a specific speed that it has to hit in order to, you know, take that jump and break that rule. If the second attempt is an RPE 9, you're not gonna go a huge jump. Even if it's an RPE 8, you're probably not gonna do a huge jump. You'll stick with the plan, take the same size jump as the first or second, or maybe even smaller. But if it's moving like, you know, RPE 6 or RPE sub 6, then you know you can take a big jump, even if it is bigger than the first and second, even if it feels heavy on their back, and you're not gonna go from RPE 6 to failing most likely. You might go to RPE 6, you know, RPE 9, or maybe 9.5. Sometimes you're still gonna have some more in the tank. Like even for that third attempt, you may have been able to do another 2.5 kilos and be able to grind through that middle portion. So it kind of set maybe a if-then statement. If the second attempt looks like a warm-up, or if the second attempt looks like RPE 6, then we'll go to this. And even for your regular options for your third attempts, you can do that as well. You can say, hey, if the second attempt is RPE 9, we're gonna take the smaller one. If the second attempt is RPE 8, we'll take the bigger option. So you can do things like that to basically set standards for yourself, and not on the fly when there's 6 seconds on the clock to turn in your next attempt, being like, I'm not sure, it kind of felt good. And you're thinking of, like, you know, subjective, arbitrary things and saying, okay, let's go with this. Try and make it more objective and more standardized that you're gonna base on a specific RPE or, you know, velocity. If you're basically looking at bar speed, you're good at being able to see the bar speed and where the person's gonna fail in the lift, and then using that as a decision for the third attempt. But we'll move on to the bench press. For the bench press, the highest he hit in the training cycle was 220 pounds. And it was basically, you know, all out grinder, RPE 9.5 or 10, whatever you want to call it. So my plan was, okay, let's do 92.5 for the opener, it's about 203 pounds. 97.5 for the second, it's 215 pounds, just under that difficult rep that he hit in training. And then go for the 100, which is 220, or 102.5, which is 226, at a third attempt to either match what he did in training, or maybe get another 2.5 kilos if he's feeling good and we get a good press command and he's well recovered compared to training. So first and second attempt went fine, nothing too great. So we were deciding between a 100 and 102.5, and we finally said, okay, let's just go with the 102.5. He's gonna have to fight through off the chest, but it's gonna be there. And then you can see in the video, it's pretty sloppy, difficult off the chest, almost had a little bit of downward motion, and then finally was able to lock it out and get it. So definitely difficult attempt in his max. It would have been obviously safer to go with the 100, but we went with the 102.5, do a little bit more than we did in training, and move on to the deadlift. So for deadlift, the most he did in training was 390 pounds, but it was actually the easiest of the three in training. So I had thought that he had the most potential to do more in the competition. Plus, for a lot of people, when it comes to deadlift, you know, they have the most adrenaline in the competition. They're not as fatigued from squat in a competition compared to their squat training. If they're deadlifting after squatting or even the day after, you may still be fatigued. So the plan was to go 167.5, about 370 pounds, then 177.5, about 391, and then 182.5 or 185, 402 or 407. So that the 390, you know, I thought there was a lot in there, so we can go 402 or 407 and you'd be able to get it. But what would happen is, you know, 167.5 flew off the ground. We worked on this little technique a little bit in the warm-up room as well, and it looked easy. So I said, okay, instead of doing what we did for squat where it took the bigger jump from second to third, let's just increase our second attempt a little bit. That would still have give us room to, you know, take the more conservative third if we need to, but give us more space to go up. So what I did instead of doing the 177.5 is I went up to 180, 396. So now we're going a little bit above what he's hit in training for that cycle, but he's hit more before. And the single that he hit in training during this cycle, it was easy that I thought he had 396 no matter what. So we did the 180. He got that, and that was easy as well. So now that we had room to work with, we don't have to, you know, take the 182.5 or 185 because we're at 177.5. Now we've taken a 12.5 kilo jump from first to second, and we have more room to go up for the third. And since the second attempt was very easy as well, we took another 12.5 kilo jump and went to 190, 418 because he's hit more than that 425 or 430 or something like that in previous cycles when he was training himself. So figured, okay, 418 is gonna be close to what he's hit before. He's gonna be based off of what he's doing for the second attempt. It's gonna be a good number for him to, you know, maximize the day and finish on a good note. I didn't wanna go too much higher than that and risk the possibility of missing that and then, you know, ending on a miss and leaving so much out of there on the deadlift and kind of like, you know, finishing on a down. We wanted to finish on a high note. So we took a big jump, but a conservative jump still that I thought he was capable of getting. And as you can see in the video, he was able to get it. So able to finish 9 for 9 on that day, making all attempts, including those adjustments for squat deadlift. And for bench press, we just stuck with the plan. And then the other thing worth mentioning, which I just said a little bit earlier, is about technique or making adjustments the day of. Typically, you don't want to make any major adjustments the day of, but this was an opportunity for us to work together in person, since, like I said, he was doing my free program, and also he lives in a different city in Florida. We can't work together. So some things I went over with him on Instagram, just through Messenger, telling him, hey, this is how you want to walk out your squat, or hey, this is how you want to set up for your deadlift. Sometimes, like, you know, you can make small improvements there. Sometimes the person may not understand the cue you're giving them, or may not completely understand the position they're supposed to get in when they're by themselves and they can't see everything like that. So there are some benefits, because it was his first meet. It's not a big deal if he had missed any of those attempts, because, you know, he can build on that base for the first meet. But there is a lot of benefit to going over these small technical changes in person and making sure he really gets it down, so that now his future training's gonna be much better, because his technique's gonna be better on all three lifts, and he's gonna be able to progress more. So it's worth working on these little things. For squat, the major thing that he had was that his feet were too far back behind him when he was unracking the bar. So he wasn't doing like a leg press and standing straight up with his legs. He was kind of doing like a good morning and using his back. So that was the only thing we were working on leading up, and just making sure at the meet that he was doing it correctly to not stress out his lower back for his squat attempts. For bench press, it's like, you know, a lot of people have trouble figuring out how to get into an arch, how to get their feet underneath them and drive their toes to get that leg drive. People kind of just, like, you know, put their feet down a little bit more relaxed, or maybe at a 90 degree angle for their knee joint. And so it's just like physically, you know, getting him in position that I want him to, like pulling the feet back, showing him how to get the chest up and arching, pushing the toes through the front of the shoes to get a little bit of a bigger arch and get a little bit more of the weight on the shoulders. So that's the main thing we worked on the bench press, was just getting that arch and that tight setup, and the actual press itself was fine. And for deadlift, for a lot of people, it's figuring out that correct starting position. A lot of people want to sit too far down in a deadlift thinking it's a squat. A lot of people end up pushing the bar forward of the midfoot, going over the toes, and even on sumo, having a forward shin angle. So we had to just work on that starting position, getting the bar over the middle of the foot, trying to keep the shins as vertical as possible for the sumo starting position, making sure the hips are higher than the knees, having tension in that hamstring, and of course having tension with the bar by pulling the slack out of the bar. So it's one tight unit, everything is wedged in there, ready to explode, and then when you initiate the pull, everything comes up together, rather than having, you know, the hip shoot up and the torso tips over and yanking the bar and all that kind of stuff. So that was a major thing we had to work on for deadlift, was that starting position. So hopefully you've enjoyed this video. Maybe you got a little bit of a takeaway as far as, like, you know, remembering to bring your equipment, when you should break the rules and how to break the rules, and then if it's worth, you know, making technical changes the day of the competition or not. But other than that, if you want to learn more about attempt selection strategy, check out these videos I have here, where you can learn about beginner and advanced attempt selection strategies, so you can improve your game day strategy and make sure you dominate on the platform. But other than that, hope you guys are having a good week and not as tired as I am, and I'll see you in the next video.